few years back, I studied a mime technique called Decroux technique, named after this guy called Etienne Decroux, who was an early 20th century theatre maker, mime artist kind of guy. It's the kind of mime that, you know, eventually became that stuff you see in Covent Garden, you know, robotics and all that kind of stuff. It demands a kind of special, kind of a high level of kind of bodily control, really, to perform these kind of illusions. And the way you train for it, the way you teach yourself it, really. I mean, there's specific regimes you go through and specific things you have to learn. But it does focus an awful lot on mirrors. You stand in front of a mirror, basically, for hours on end, practicing these rotations and translations and this, that and the other. And kind of watching yourself in the mirror and seeing what happens when you do this thing with your body. So you're kind of mapping your internal sense of what your body's up to on a moment-to-moment basis with the outer contours of your body and what visible movements your body's making. Because it's very deceptive, you know, when you first start, you think you're doing something, you know, you think you're doing this particular move, and you look in the mirror and you're doing something completely different. Or you think you're standing straight up and you find that one of your shoulders is considerably higher than the other. So, a lot of it is about, you know, kind of establishing a viable relationship and a good correspondence between how you, between your kinesthetic map, I suppose, and your visual appearance. The reason why I'm saying about that is that it seems to me that use of the mirror to establish, that use of the mirror to try to establish that kinesthetic relationship to the visual is a little bit similar to what's happening in mirror neurons, and I'm probably stretching the definition a bit here, never mind. Because in neuronal mirroring, if I understand it correctly, the visual appearance of a person's activity causes an activation pattern in the brain which starts to simulate in your body, partially or fully, a kinesthetic equivalent to that. So the studies with babies, you know, if a mother puts the tongue out, the baby puts its tongue out. In other words, what the baby is seeing visually is mapped onto and then reproduced kinesthetically in the baby's body. So there's a translation across those two kinesthetic maps, what they see visually to what's happening kinesthetically. I don't know why I'm talking about that really. I guess I'm just following up on some of the stuff I was warbling on about yesterday. Decroux mime isn't any kind of a therapeutic technique as far as I'm aware. But it does have that, has that same property, which I think you find in other techniques like some meditation practices like Tai Chi, but also in things like body-mind centering, that kind of stuff, where you're trying to make alignments between one aspect of your psychological experience of yourself and your actions and another. So whether it be that part of yourself that you present visually with that part of yourself that you're kind of kinesthetically walking around with, or whether it be some notion of the center or something else, I don't know. Seems like there's a relationship there.